Parental discretion is advised.
This show is brought to you by Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, sliceonbroadway.com. And listeners like you, support this show at patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. Just wait, just wait. Hey guys, it's the Wrestling Mayhem Show, episode 531. Tuesdays we've been doing this, talking professional wrestling, the general professional wrestling, usually WWE, but we get into a little bit of everything all across. Mike Sorg here in Mayhem Studios in Pittsburgh, PA, ready to get rocking with this stuff tonight. First of all, joining us, one of our main co-hosts, joining us from Poughkeepsie, New York, it is Mad Mike.
Hi, Sorg. SmackDown sure happened, didn't it?
It did. The initial SmackDown post-show reaction, I guess, is how this show is going to go from now on, thanks to scheduling and such. But also with us from San Antonio, Texas. I think he's still there, but soon to relocate.
Well, I'm currently in Corpus Christi, Texas.
Where are you? Where in Texas? Who are you? What's with that hair? And you just, you're a little dark underneath. Oh, no, you're fine. I'm looking at the wrong monitor. Eamon Payton, he's the voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling out of Austin, Texas, actually. How you doing?
I'm doing great. SmackDown was great for what I've seen.
It'll be fantastic. I'm sure it'll be just fine. Everything's going to be just fine by SummerSlam. They only have the biggest title. But also, a special guest, I can't believe it's taken me this long to get this guy back on one of our shows. Referee extraordinaire Jake Clemens, Clemens Jake on the Twitter, is joining us tonight. How you doing, man?
Doing well. Thanks for asking. Thanks for having me back.
Awesome. And what did we say? You were on like in 2014 on the Indie Mayhem show. Is that right?
August 4th, 2014.
Oh, geez. That's like an anniversary. We're going to be chatting up all the wrestling news this week. But of course, you can check out everything at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Subscribe to this show and so much more on iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, iHeartRadio, YouTube, Facebook, all kinds of places, video and audio formats. And you can also drop us a line at 412-206-WMS0 or that email address.
Good times
at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Let us know your thoughts on the wrestling for the week. Or you can go over to the Wrestling Mayhem Show Facebook group. A lot of great conversations happening there. Or at Mayhem Show on the Twitters. And also you can support the show, as mentioned at the top during the intro there, patreon.com/WrestlingMayhemShow, including our longtime Patreon supporters, thewrestlingrevolution.com, Mr. Antonio Garza from over there, who's like on the beach or something, according to his Facebook page. He's living it up this summer. But also our good friend, Bo Diggity.
Woo!
The Jennifer and Matthew Carlins Foundation for Podcast Betterment, Bobby FJ Town, the new one on there, Ed Burke, and Alex Cars, all supporting the show, putting their money where our microphones are, over at patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. Thank you so much for supporting the show. You guys can too. A little is a penny. Every little bit helps. Or just tell friends about it and help spread the word of mayhem and help the nation grow. All right. So, I mean, the biggest story is still kind of the how is the post-draft era? And I think we have a lot of reactions from that. We talked a lot about it on Raw Wrap-Up last night. SmackDown tonight was, I'm sure Mike will say, SmackDown. So I think looking at this thing, is it pretty much solidarity that Raw's kind of winning out on this?
Yeah.
It's
just, I think I mentioned this before on the show. It just feels weird. Like, I feel like they just designed this whole thing very weird. Like, if you're looking at the two people that are like the authority figures of each show, I feel like this should be switched.
Mm-hmm.
Like, SmackDown's not bad, but SmackDown feels like the Stephanie McMahon-run show, and Raw feels more like the Shane McMahon-run show, but it's the opposite. Like, I don't get it. Like,
either that or Stephanie should have to like butt heads with Daniel Bryan as opposed to generally agreeing with Mick Foley.
Yeah, and it's like Steph's like, I agree, we're gonna do all this stuff, and it's all the stuff the crowd wants, and it's like, okay, like, and Shane's like, bring me back Rhino and these guys, and it's like, okay, it just is weird. Like, I'm not saying SmackDown's bad, but it just feels like the product we've kind of been getting the past couple of years, as opposed to Raw, which is trying to be more modern and different.
Mm-hmm. And Jake, we were talking before the show. You said, you know, as I think we've kind of, you know, made kind of the same line. Things seemed wonky straight from the draft.
I'm sorry, what was that?
You got the feeling that things seemed kind of wonky, like from the offset with the draft a few weeks ago.
Yeah, draft. That's really the only WWE I've watched in the past probably 2 years. It's nothing against their product. I would love to obviously work for WWE someday or Impact Wrestling, but I actually liked the draft. It was interesting. They threw things out there that were unexpected. I didn't expect Mojo Rawley. I didn't expect Braun Strowman to go to Raw. Some little things like that, but overall, I thought it was good for the product and kind of switches things up, you know.
Certainly. Mike, you had kind of an interesting question about kind of how to switch things up, since, you know, we're kind of seeing how things are going and how things feel. You want to tell us about that?
Well, yeah, I mean, because it feels like Raw has been able to say, hey, we got the women's champion, we have the tag team champions, we're going to have a cruiserweight division. And SmackDown says, we have a post show. So
talking
I'm wondering
smack.
Because it.
They actually call it a talking smack.
They actually call it talking smack. And because I have it on the network on silent. It's literally just talking.
Well, like, I mean, that's what those post shows are usually.
I know, but like, you can do some, like, SmackDown. Here's my problem. SmackDown doesn't feel fresh at all. It doesn't even feel like you're looking at the same house with a new coat of paint. Like, it just looks like it's the same old blue brand. Like, I probably could have told you most of what would happen on SmackDown without ever watching it tonight. And I just feel like, if we could all make one trade from Raw to SmackDown that would help both brands, I'm just curious what you guys think you would do for that.
I have half of that mind. I'm thinking, when I would think of somebody who would go from SmackDown to Raw, I'm thinking of someone like Baron Corbin.
Are we trying to help the brand, or are we trying to help the wrestler?
Yes.
Both, yeah. Well, I think both, because you need – I think Baron Corbin has proven in NXT that he can be a good antagonist. And I think on SmackDown, he just kind of blends in a bit too much with some of the other people. When you have him on some ways like Raw, where you have a lot of the younger talents, and especially like if they're going to start doing the Cruiserweight division, you can really still continue that great storyline he was doing in NXT, which is, I hate everyone that's coming from the independents and I'm going to destroy them all. Like, I thought that was something really cool that he was doing. And I think on Raw, he would stand out more and would be able to execute on more of a level. And you would have a good antagonist in that realm, so to speak.
And it would be great, though, if we did get Baron Corbin just yell at AJ Styles, go back to Ring of Honor.
Yeah. Go back to the Impact Zone.
Go back to the Impact Zone. Exactly.
But the other side, I'm not sure. I'm trying to think.
Yeah, like me personally, because I've been thinking about this, I would send Randy Orton to Raw and bring Cesaro to SmackDown.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
Actually, yes. Either Cesaro or Kevin Owens.
I would say Cesaro would be my other half then. Yeah, that's what I would do.
So, Mike, you have a little more to that. You're talking with us on the Hangout here as we were watching SmackDown. You're kind of more on the side. You hate that we're doing the, oh, they're on different brands and running in security thing with Brock and Randy Orton.
Yeah, because the whole idea of this draft was to have the brands be separate and distinct, and we're already running an inter-brand angle. Mm-hmm. Like, well, those brands should not cross until Survivor Series.
I agree. I think Brock and Randy has a slight exception. My big issue, like, to that realm is, like, looking at some of the house show lineups that are coming up, and they're all multi-branded. And, like, they kind of it just kind of defeats the purpose for me, because the whole concept was these guys on these separate brands are never going to get to see each other again. Mm-hmm. They're going to be in their own little worlds, and technically they're not. Like,
you kind of feel like, you kind of feel like,
I've even heard that after Raw, dark matches have like Cena and AJ in them.
Well, yeah. Yep. Well, here's the thing.
Why are you driving them out to Raw?
No. Wait. We're 2 weeks into this. The draft happened, and literally nobody really knows what show they're going to be on. Like, you know, we talked about the reactions from the NXT people that didn't even know they were going to be called up, right? Mm-hmm. And I know here in Pittsburgh, we got Cena and Bray and a bunch of people, Dean, you know, that weren't even on Raw, but they were advertised for the show. These are the general lineups, and yeah, they can change, but they were generally have been advertised for months. They're going to stick with that, right?
But Sword, card subject to change. It says
card subject to change, but you don't want to piss off everybody that bought a ticket for the next month while we resort things into these new things.
If you're buying a ticket for Raw for the dark match, you don't know why you're buying a ticket for Raw.
No. There are people that did buy tickets because John Cena was on the thing, because Dean Ambrose was on the thing.
I mean, I understand that.
They're your general fan.
I also just don't understand why we're doing dark matches these past couple weeks on Raw when, like, you have really stellar main events.
There's a whole other philosophy.
You don't need
on
to
that.
Send the fans home happy. Like, mm-hmm. I don't know. You already did it.
Yeah, I've been to Raws where they've advertised dark matches, and those dark matches just haven't happened.
But I think,
like, that's a thing. You know, you come out beforehand, say, "Hey, John Cena is not going to be here. If you want your refund, go get your refund."
And also,
watch the product. He's not on. He's not on.
Beyond that, the logistics. Remember, everybody travels themselves, as far as these go, and travel plans have been like laid out for these people and the legs of tours that they do and everything for weeks. That's also a little harder. Maybe it's one thing to say, yeah, John Cena can get on whatever private plane and do whatever, but for an R-Truth and whoever, you know, they've booked that out, you know, the logistical nightmare that probably is, you know, having done a little bit of travel for business this year, I couldn't even imagine. Like, I have that is gaining respect for what these guys have to do on a weekly basis.
Okay, I can understand.
This is a bigger logistical thing than just the booking doesn't make sense.
But WWE is the one that's setting the schedule.
Right.
If they know that they're putting John Cena on SmackDown, maybe tell him not to travel to where Raw's going.
I honestly don't know, but
maybe think out the draft well in advance. It's not like this was sprung on anyone.
I agree, but also I don't know if they completely think out the draft.
Yeah,
there was rumors that they didn't know who the NXT called for going to be.
Yeah, I know, but that's the problem. That is the actual physical problem with this. They should have thought this out. They should have made it so these guys aren't surprised by having to adjust travel plans. Like, you don't have to have a surprise. These people are actors. They can act surprised. They can act upset that they aren't drafted high. Like, the NXT call-ups, I get. That's different. That's a completely different thing. That's a surprising thing for the NXT people. But the people on the main roster should have known exactly what show they're going to be on weeks before the draft.
Mm-hmm.
I guess I agree. I think maybe the mentality, either it's that they don't know before, they don't plan enough ahead, or that they don't want stuff to leak. I don't know. But I think
it's a little bit of all that, to be quite honest.
Yeah, but going back to like the whole like building your own separate brand and stuff like that, I do feel like, you know, Raw has done a decent job of making, like I said, at least feeling like a different show. I mean, the set's not completely different. They just added a like bar in the middle of it. But like other than that, like it really feels like a new show.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it feels like we've started something different. Obviously, you got existing characters and stuff like that, but they're like, okay, we're going to do something new. We got to, you know, do something different.
And as silly as it sounds, they move the announcers. They move the announcers. Like, that's a small change, but it makes Raw feel different. It makes like they're actually trying something different. You can shoot SmackDown differently. You can put the hard camera on the ramp like they did for the old ECW show, and you get to see the announcers the whole time. Like, right. It's a small change, but it makes it look different than what you've been watching every Tuesday/Thursday/Friday for the past 15 years.
And I also feel like it's very weird that, like, SmackDown should almost be more in, like, a position to succeed with the fact that they have one less hour than Raw. Like, obviously, they got more picks in the draft, but even then, like, Raw is going to have to stretch until they get more of the cruiserweight talent, obviously. But they're going to still have to kind of stretch a little bit
as we talked about last night, I feel like Raw feels like the tighter show.
Yeah, and it's weird. It's weird because, like,
That's because every match on Raw has had, say it with me now, purpose. Except for that Sami Rollins match, which had no storyline basis behind it, every other match on Raw had a story behind it.
I would even argue they did a bit of with the Seth and Sami one, where Seth was like, I'm going to beat up your old buddy in NXT, Finn.
Yeah, I think there was a plenty that happened there. Jake, I want to break Jake in on this a little bit. What do you think, Jake, you know, you would like to see, like, really make a difference for some of these shows to really kind of step apart?
To set Raw and SmackDown apart?
Yeah, or make any of them feel like even newer.
You could shoot it differently, you know, like, I think that was said. I don't know about shooting from the ramp. I think that would maybe be a little issue, like, for the refs. They would have to learn, from their perspective, they would have to learn a new way how to work around the cameras to work that hard cam. They would have to essentially work the ramp, which would – the way they normally do it, you only work two sides of the crowd because the camera's shooting and you obviously don't turn your back to the hard cam. So you've got the one side with the ramp, which has minimal people on it. You've got the hard cam shot, which has got a lot of people. Then you've got the side with the commentators, which has got a lot. So if you put it on the ramp, then you're all around the fans. I think they could do little things to shoot it different, but it's so hard to say, like, from production standpoints and wrestling standpoints, what to do. Honestly, it's difficult for sure.
Mm-hmm.
And I could also, or go ahead, sorry.
I was going to say, and I think we also need to take into account that we already have like two other growing products for, quote, different wrestling happening on the network in NXT and now the Cruiserweight Classic. Like, even Cruiserweight Classic, I feel, and I haven't caught up with you guys on the CWC midweek war, what your discussion has been there. But other than Eamon, I'm glad that you found friends to talk about British wrestling with lately.
Yes.
over there. But you know, there are different things that are different brands, and now we have Raw and SmackDown splitting on top of that. You know, think when we did this, 12 years ago or however long ago it was, we didn't also have these other things going on in the WWE landscape, right? It was, oh, we're going to have two separate things, and it was more to it. Now it's like, oh, so now I have four things to follow in WWE now, right? I feel like SmackDown feels like where NXT was when it started, when I was still trying to figure out what it was, right?
SmackDown still feels taped.
Yeah, a little bit.
It still feels taped. Like, yeah. I know it's live. I know they're doing it right now. It still feels taped because every single thing has been predictable on.
So then, no. Okay, I'm going to stop you right now because you know what is not predictable? Both women's matches.
Daniel Bryan calling Apollo Crews. Apollo. Oh, there's Creed. That too.
Both women's matches not happening. That's not.
Well, yeah.
That's not.
I mean, Okay, the Eva Marie one, I'll grant you that wasn't predictable. Mm-hmm. Natty's been attacking everyone from behind.
That's true, too. That's true, too.
But again, you don't do that gag twice on the same show.
It feels like they're trying different things. Everybody's trying different things. Raw did all this stuff to make the feel different. Like walking into Raw in Pittsburgh last week, I was like, oh, this is different. Okay, you know, and into the music and seeing the gnarly crane cam that comes from the ceiling now that Matt Carlins and I were both like, ooh, I want one of those for IWC in my personal projects. Could you imagine we had a crane cam from the ceiling, like in the studio? It would just be me surrounded by computers, but still, it would be the sweetest.
Wait, are you sure we don't?
It would be the sweetest podcast shot ever. But so
we can call that the Ultimate X Owl Cam.
Yeah, there you go. There you go. Sponsored by Slice on Broadway. But I feel like SmackDown is making efforts to feel different, and we're doing this crazy backstage set that is awkward and doesn't work. We're doing this stuff. We're bringing these girls in and trying to do this. And again, maybe some selections there. I feel like after tonight, I feel like we've been saying this about Dana Brooke, but I feel like Carmella needs to bake a little bit more in NXT. You know, after mm-hmm. what I've seen tonight.
I don't think she needs to beg more. I mean, I think at this point it's going to be like a symptom kind of thing.
I'm so glad that you've adopted my terminology for it needs more NXT time.
Yeah. Needs a little more time in the oven. But no.
the NXT easy bake oven.
Yes.
And that's not a slight on the women's division.
And maybe it's just from the fact that they don't have a women's title right now. It's rumored. Well, it's not rumored. Daniel Bryan was on a radio show and said that they're going to bring in a women's title. But, it just felt like, oh, everyone's kind of disjointed and doing their own thing. It's like I felt the first SmackDown week, where it's like, oh, here's all the women we have. They're going to come out and say a line, and then the next one's going to come out. And I'm like, okay. As opposed to Raw, where they're building this really great feud between Sasha and Charlotte. They're building up Nia Jax. Like I would say SmackDown has technically the women's roster, but like Raw is doing a better job with them. It's mm-hmm. weird. It's yeah.
Yeah. And can we talk about that? That set that they're doing with Renee Young.
The oddly right. cavernous desk in the back.
Yeah.
It's
Renee
set.
Young interviewed Dean Ambrose
right.
on the thing. Okay.
Right.
Why is it that every single relationship on Total Divas is referenced, but Renee and Dean still have to pretend they're not dating?
Yeah.
Why is that?
Because she's an interviewer?
That's really, really weird.
Is it because she's an interviewer? Maybe?
So what?
No, I think that's context.
They
always married
that's context. To an Uso, for Christ's sake.
I think that's absolutely context.
I think it's weird. It's super duper weird.
I think it would be nice for them to mention it.
Sorg, they've been on Swerved together, for Christ's sake.
Okay.
Like, it seems like I feel like they would have a better segment if Renee could show, oh, I don't know, concern that Bray Wyatt is after his title.
Maybe
Dolph Ziggler's getting really intense. I feel like that would be a better segment.
Maybe it's from a case of like either they behind the scenes or Renee herself doesn't want to be like a storyline plot point. Maybe like she wants to be just the announcer. You know what I mean? Or the people there want her to be just the announcer and don't want her to be involved in like storylines or whatever. I think it would be nice, but you know, maybe that's what I think it seems like.
Then don't put her on the same show as her boyfriend.
Man.
Well, up until now that was every show.
Yeah,
so I don't think that's something. I don't think that is a factor for them making these decisions, but. All right. Well, from there, want to give a shout out to indiewrestling.us. If you're very confused by what's happening on wrestling, main wrestling, check out some of the up and comers or where some of these guys were beforehand. Hey, Rhino just popped up. And oh, wait, hey, look at that poster I just put up there. There's Rhino and Tommy Dreamer. Jake, did you ref that match? I can't remember. I know you were probably on that show last year on Cage Fury, right?
Yeah, I was on Cage Fury 2015. I didn't ref Rhino and Tommy Dreamer. I think Bobby Potter was the ref for that.
Mm-hmm. So it's a good time there. Good, some great stuff. We just posted last week the IWC Wipeout show, including sexy talented dudes in as lifeguards. It was insane. I recommend checking it out. A lot of people are picking that up, actually. Almost as many people that were picking up Super Indie in the first week, which is incredible, since Super Indie was a highly, highly rated show. I know PW Insider had nothing but great things to say about it in their review. So check it out. And of course, just posted today RWA's Resurrection. A great show with friends of the show like J-Rock, the Patriot, Super Hentai, Marshall Gambino making debuts on that show. Bobby Shields. I haven't seen Bobby Shields in a while. Holy crap, is he jacked now. And he's been, I know if you follow his Instagram, you've probably been seeing his bodybuilding stuff going on. But it was good to see those guys and a great, great crew down there. And we have some fun over the RWA Facebook page. We actually did 360 video of the ring entrances. So if you want to get, hey, WWE, you're not the only ones that can do this. Okay, it's not The Undertaker, but still, you know, it's still pretty fun. You can see me hiding in the bathroom while I'm trying to take the video because it's 360 degrees. You can see wheels setting up and dealing with sound while everybody's coming out. It's a lot of fun over at the Renegade Wrestling Alliance Facebook page. And also actually posted on the listing for RWA's Resurrection 2016. Check it out. Sign up for the newsletter. Get news about the latest releases, sales, and this, the Wrestling Mayhem Show, and everything we're doing around here at WrestlingMayhemShow.com and around the indies, which has, as Matt Carlin says, the best thumbnail image ever for his Around the Indies column. So there you go. Check it out. IndieWrestling.us. So from there, let's move on a bit, and I don't know how much there is to say about this, but I don't think we've talked a whole lot about Brock Lesnar post UFC and everything going on there. Of course, I know, Mike, you've talked a little bit about how you don't like how there's this split going on, and I agree, it's a little odd, and I still think there's just some things that they kind of set into motion before they decided what they wanted to do with the draft. And again, we've talked before, there's so many moving parts and so many people involved versus, you know, whenever they did the draft the first time, as far as people involved and plans, and we didn't have 3 hours of Raw, you know, et cetera, I think. You know, what do we feel, first of all, Randy Orton, do we feel like he was kind of the right opponent at this time, or is he kind of like the last opponent for Brock Lesnar at this rate?
Randy Orton's the never the right opponent, sort of.
I don't mind it. Like, I can understand the perspective of it. I mean, two guys that came in around the same time were considered to be top level stars, you know, it's a match I've never done before. Sure, I can understand it. There's probably a bunch of other people I would like to see Brock face. Well, actually, you know what? No. Actually, I'm going to rescind that. This is the perfect opponent for Brock Lesnar. Because Brock Lesnar against any other guy, as much as we want it really badly, is not going to come off the way we want it to come off.
What do you mean by that?
I think we saw that with Ambrose at Mania. I would love Brock Kevin Owens, but we know how that's going to come off.
I don't necessarily think that's true.
I think it is. I think Brock either... Maybe it's ego, maybe it's, you know, the way he's built up, maybe it's like, oh, he's too big of a star, whatever. But I don't know. I can't see him really being on that level of somebody, you know, or letting somebody get to his level in that regard. Mm-hmm. Because we saw it with Dean at Mania. Just the way the match was structured, like, it wasn't done in a way to make Dean look good at all. I would say even the matches he's had with Seth Rollins, like he's had like that quick thing with him at Mania and then that the triple threat at Royal Rumble. That was really good. But look at the singles match he had with Rollins. Like, he dominated him completely.
Right.
And it was
I think that's because Seth and Dean are smaller guys. I think if you put Brock in against like a physical specimen, like maybe a Cesaro, I think that's a different match. And I think that's a match a lot of people want to see. And it actually takes the name of Brock Lesnar and elevates who he's wrestling. Randy Orton does not need that rub. Randy Orton has already wrestled Brock Lesnar back in like 2004.
It feels like it's more than just...
But I think that, you know, other than Dean and Seth, who are the other guys that Brock's wrestled? Taker, Cena, Triple H...
Right.
You know, guys like that. That's who they're going to position him against.
Hey, Kofi Kingston.
We all saw how that went.
Kofi.
Big Show.
Big Show.
Big Show. Of course, Big Show.
But that's my point. Like, they're going to position him against those guys. Like, if they position him against anyone lower card, the result's going to be the same. I'm sorry. I am hopeful that if they were to one day be like, we're going to do Brock Cesaro, like, if they actually do, and you're right, that's a match people will want to see. 100%. I want to see that match so badly, but in the right world.
Brock is the showcase. You know what I mean? I mean, and aside from something like completely one-sided, like a Kofi, like we're going to put him in Madison Square Garden, we're going to put him in the Tokyo show, as like Brock was here and that's all we really need him to be. I think if he's taking on anybody that doesn't have multiple championship wins and doesn't have a giant has been made basically, I don't think it's worth putting Brock against in their eyes and the money they're probably spending on him, to be honest. He's there.
They're looking at it all wrong.
No, I agree.
I don't know. They're the ones making money, but other than that, you know, I agree.
I'm just saying that's how they're looking at it.
I think they're looking at landscape and they're like, well, who's the next guy that you know is on one of those on top guys for many years that he's really never touched? And literally, like, apparently he's never really touched Randy Orton, even back when they were both coming up or anything like that. I think they just missed each other now I think about it. And I can't remember if they were on separate brands or what the case was.
They were
on separate brands. So you have something there. And, on top of that, Randy Orton being fresh off of 9 months off. I mean, RKO chance both nights here. I mean, we were Raw until, you know, Raw is still ending with RKO chance. Okay, cool. You know, he's got some stock there. People do like Randy Orton, whether you do or not.
People like the RKO.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's something exciting and comes out of nowhere. Jake, what do you think about the Brock Lesnar stuff going into SummerSlam? Is Randy Orton a matchup you like to see?
Yeah, definitely. From recent memory, I don't remember them ever wrestling each other. They may have earlier in their careers, but I think as Orton was on the rise in 2004, I believe Brock was. I know he was around, but I think Orton was always on Raw, and Brock was always on SmackDown. And I don't remember if they've wrestled, but they may have. But it's definitely going to be interesting for sure. I do listen to like reviews of Raw and SmackDown the next day through the Taz show actually. And you mentioned PW Insider, which I want to give a shout out to Mike Johnson because I really like Mike Johnson and he needs to come to a show in Pittsburgh or Cleveland as soon as possible. So, but they did say something about Orton showed up on Raw last night, but he's a SmackDown guy and said it might be a little too early for the SmackDown guys show up on Raw, but I guess this match was booked before the draft, so it kind of makes sense, I guess.
That's true. But yeah, I will say the one person, Brock and Randy are the only person to appear on different shows, because I will give credit to one of the best things coming from the draft, and that's Heath Slater.
Yes.
Yeah, definitely. That was, it's hilarious. And then Jinder Mahal showing up was very surprising.
I would have given WWE every dollar imaginable if they just happened to get Drew Galloway to like jump from TNA to WWE just in one segment with the 3MB.
Okay, so I looked it up. Apparently, Randy Orton and Brock Lesnar, the last time they wrestled was right after Brock's debut in September of 2002.
Okay.
I think there was like a, because there was a brief time when Randy was on the SmackDown brand, like back right. when he was a young up and comer, like
yeah, he started like around that John Cena debut, right? Like they were the new yeah. ruthless aggression guys that were there that they were bringing in from OVW at the time.
Yeah. But still, like that's Randy Orton before he even closely developed into.
That's not
now.
RKO. That's not Viper and Brock Lesnar.
Yeah, that's when
even...
he was still using the overdrive.
Oh, yes.
Okay. All right. I mean, it's pretty legacy. You know, that's like pupil stage.
Pre-evolution.
Randy Orton.
It's literally the pre-evolution of Randy Orton.
Yeah. Exactly. Wow. Wow. Interesting.
Yeah.
So he evolves into that. As he evolves into the Viper, he got enough Randy Orton candies and he evolved into a Viper.
SmackDown go.
I was going to say, this is before Randy News Network. Remember that?
Randy, what? What was Randy News Network?
Remember when Randy like injured his shoulder or something like that and he would cut in the middle of matches to give like CNN-style updates about how he was recovering?
I'm looking this up on YouTube. I don't
that
remember.
That was possibly
this.
The best Randy Orton. I remember there was a match Shawn Michaels had, and he was like, Randy was talking about this stewardess that treated him really well on the air, on the flight.
Geez, I just found it.
In the middle of some important like segment.
I'm pulling.
It might have even been like in the middle of a Gold Rush tournament.
Oh, we're completely getting pulled down from WWE when I put this on YouTube. But that holy crap, look at that hair. For you guys on video, I'm sorry.
Yeah,
the co-host
oh yeah,
can't
he, had,
see
he had
this.
The Justin Timberlake in 1999
Jeez,
haircut, but
man, you
the
just
tips.
Wanted to punch him in the face for being.
But yeah, it would be like two guys about to rip their throats out and like some big feud, and Randy would just cut in with the announcement, being like, "This is what I ate for breakfast this morning. I'll be back soon."
And that was basically the heel turn, right? Like he got hurt.
Yeah, kind of, yeah.
He
yeah,
got
basically.
Hurt, and then he just turned into a big dick, right?
And hasn't really changed much since.
No. Just kind of this so cool. Yeah.
He seemed like he was happy to be there at Battleground. Don't give him that.
The time when he was happy. Exactly. All right, guys. It's been a fun discussion. We're going to go to the break here. We'll be back with the big question. But first, I want to give shouts to our friend Slice on Broadway, supporting the Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza up here in Beachview. I know a lot of you guys some people from out of town checking it out, heading into their location at PNC Park, home of the Pittsburgh Pirates. Give them a shout, sliceonbroadway.com, PTH_slice on the Twitter, and let them know you heard about it on the Mayhem Show. We'll be back with a big question after this.
This is the Iron Sheik. You listen to the Mayhem Show. Iran, number one. Russia, number one.
Hey guys, it is the Wrestling Mayhem Show. It's the big question time. We got the crew here. Jake Clemens, pro wrestling referee extraordinaire. He's sharing with us his absolution experiences with AIW. We talked with John Thorne of AIW on the Indie Mayhem Show recently. Go check that out. And also, the card is going to change. I actually remember what the name of that podcast is now that I listen to all the time. Also, Mad Mike up in Poughkeepsie, New York, the only one on the show currently that is a former employee of WWE. And, of course, the voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling, Eamon Payton, down there in Corpus Christi, where if there's a show, somebody's going in the river. I'm sorry, the Gulf of Mexico. That's a Gulf.
No,
not a
it's
river.
Pretty much. It's like a well, no, it's like a bay.
It's like
not
a bay.
Really the Gulf of Mexico.
What a, you know, Eamon, have you gone swimming in that bay?
I don't think I'm allowed to.
Oh, okay. You would not share the water with the money in the bank briefcase. Illegal. It's illegal. Then nobody told Damian Sandow, apparently. All right.
Or Chavo Guerrero.
Or Chavo Guerrero.
Or Kane that one time.
Or Kane that one time.
Or Bob Holly.
No,
there have been a lot of people in that bay as well.
That's a different bay.
But yeah. No Eamon. But anyways, so we got a big question, as we usually do at this time of this show. And we actually have one that Matt Carlins submitted to us via our own Slack for Wrestling Mayhem Show. And it involves the New Day. So his big question, if you had to reconfigure the New Day, who would you split off and who would you replace that person with? So something happened. Ooh. So let's say there needs to be a Braun Strowman that has to join the New Day because somebody got hurt and didn't get drafted.
It would be Braun Strowman.
Because somebody got Luke Harper, apparently. You made just Braun. So is that your answer, Eamon? We're just going to throw Braun Strowman in the New Day? So, I mean, you know, Generation X changed. Some of these other teams have changed. Even the Freebirds had a replacement at some point, I believe. And so who would you... Who is a replacement for Freebirds?
Oh, I think that was
Gordon?
Jimmy Jam.
Jimmy Jam. So who's the Jimmy Jam?
I think Jimmy Jam was the replacement.
Who's your Jimmy Jam of the New Day? Is the other way we can.
And Mongo was in the Four Horsemen one time.
And so was Sid, and so was the other guy we're not allowed to mention.
Lex Luthor.
You know,
so
Lex
was Luger.
Lex Luger. Right, Sorg. That's the one I was talking about.
I thought we were talking about Paul Roma.
Wasn't Lex Luger? Lex Luger. I just watched the last. Yeah, Paul Roma. Oh no.
No, Eamon had right. It was Paul Roma.
Paul Roma. Yeah. Roma. Yeah.
Those are dark times.
You know what? Every great faction makes some missteps, right?
Here's a dumb question.
Hornswoggle was in DX, you guys.
Yeah. Oh God. Here's a dumb question, and I mean this in the most sensitive way possible when I say this. Does the replacement have to be black?
No. No.
I'm saying that from an honest perspective.
You saying that, the person I have in my head is black.
Well, me too, actually. But because the original gimmick was almost like kind of like spiritual preacher gimmick. Like, yeah. So it's, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know. Mine would be Big E. Because I think he can do good solo. I think he's so charismatic to where he could be solo and great in the ring. I would replace him with Apollo Crews. Because I think one thing that we don't – like Mike said it many times about Apollo Crews is that he hasn't gotten to show his personality yet. And if you follow like his stuff in Dragon Gate and all that stuff, he has a personality. He just has kind of been like smiley, I'm a babyface guy.
Yeah,
I feel like him in that environment, he could do some good stuff.
I'm glad you're telling me that because, again, I haven't seen much of him from the indies. I've only heard the name Uha Nation, right? Is his indie name. I'm like, well, he's smiling a lot, so I guess that kind of fits in and it'll bring out some personality. I thought he was personality deficient. I'm like, oh, he's the guy that's going to be smiling, he can do some great moves, and that's it. Right.
Yeah. Watch him in Akira Tozawa shake it up on Vine. So that's all I'll say.
Can you send me? Yeah, somebody send me that. I want to check that out.
Do it for the Vine.
You do it for the Vine. Yes. But Apollo Crews would be replacement, and Big E would do the solo thing. You're thinking.
Yeah.
So that makes sense.
All right. I also would take Big E out because I feel like Big E could do some really great things, but I'm going a little different than Eamon. That is who I'm replacing Big E with.
I can't see who that is.
The Boss, Sasha Banks.
Okay.
The Boss, Sasha Banks.
I get that.
We have not had a faction that had men and women in it for a very long time.
Remember when we had the new Bad Day for like 30 minutes?
Yep, and it was brilliant.
And we're like, this is amazing. And they're like, oh, it was just a one-time thing. Like, what are you doing?
Like, it was perfect. It was absolutely perfect because Sasha fits in with Xavier and Kofi so well.
Certainly.
So, I mean, and even Big E, the last time he was in a faction before the New Day, it was Team Rocket. It was Big E, Dolph, and AJ. And that was awesome, too.
Okay. Okay. Side note to that, because I actually forgot about the connection. But Mark Henry was part of the New Day for like 10 minutes too at one point.
Yeah.
Which was also
for literally 10 minutes.
Yeah. For literally 10 minutes on SmackDown, I believe. And I really kind of enjoyed that 10 minutes. So side
we
note.
We all
side
did.
Note. Yeah. We all did. Yeah. Jake. Who's going solo and who's going to be the Jimmy Jam?
I would actually put Xavier Woods solo.
Mm-hmm.
I would just like to see where that would go. And his replacement wouldn't be one person. It would be a tag team reuniting the primetime players.
Ooh.
Crossing with Kofi Kingston and Big E as the new... Yeah.
Wow.
Okay. So you're thinking like a new horseman, New Day horseman.
Yeah, I think it would be interesting. The promos would be fun. I mean, Xavier Woods is hilarious. Kofi Kingston's hilarious. Big E's hilarious. But I really, really liked the primetime players when they were a tag team. I liked when Titus would come out and he would blow the whistle and throw flags at people.
Now, I have a question. And this is... This may be the most important question I've ever asked anyone in my life. Does Bob Backlund come with that package?
Yes.
Yes. I'm all in. I'm all in. Signed, sealed, delivered. Bob Backlund in the New Day.
This is because, so this is like a New Age DX.
It would be like a New Age DX mixed with a New Age, the audience.
Yeah.
The nation of positivity.
Yes.
I love it. Because I was imagining like Bob Backlund in the Rick Rude role a little bit.
Yeah.
Yes. Bob Backlund is exactly Rick Rude. He will show up on Raw and SmackDown on the same night.
And if they went heel, China could be Nia Jax.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
You did? Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She's angling for it. So
how about you, Sorg?
I'm on the Xavier thing as well. I think he has a lot of personality and potential there that we've barely seen, I feel. And I would replace him with... Oh, I just had it.
Bob Backlund.
Bob Backlund.
Bobby Roode.
Bobby... Wow, actually.
No.
Okay, I remember now. I remember. I know why I forgot, because it was so off the wall. Nakamura.
Oh, I like that. I like that.
Yeah.
It would be the I don't know, Pan Pacific connection or something of the New Day. You know? I mean, I don't know.
It'd be New Day Japan.
New Day Japan, you know.
He's the Masahiro Cho of the NWO. Okay.
Yeah, sure.
You know, no, I think it'd be fun because I mean, how you know, I feel Nakamura crosses the language barrier and just throwing him in there, just I think that'd be a good one. So let's know what you think. Who would
and
you?
Nakamura's dance when they say WWE Tag Team Champions would be. The literal best. Best thing ever.
And possibly outlawed on the USA Network. From that, of course. So we were having actually, we fell into a discussion on Wrestling Mayhem Show Gold, which is a special extra. You can either see it when you join us here live at live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com or check out our Patreon, patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. Anybody that contributes to that actually gets to see this and it gets emailed to you. But while Jake was walking off his magic eggs in Pokemon Go, which was a thing that happened. We actually went into a conversation about kind of expectations in wrestling. And this is something, I don't know if I talked about it here on the show, but I know I've been talking with several of you guys about kind of a, you know, setting expectations in wrestling and why some people seem to never be happy with wrestling. Right. I like to have a discussion about it. I think, Eamon, I think you started with a thread of this, and I don't know at what point of the conversation we want to pick up where we left off here.
Well, I was bringing up the fact that Kurt Angle had come up in conversation and talking about a friend of mine who, like, basically was talking about the Rusev segment on Raw and about how, like, why would they design something for some to bring back Kurt Angle when they're just going to have Roman Reigns when, like, it's not confirmed at all that Kurt Angle's coming back in WWE. Like, it's not confirmed at all. But there's an expectation that Kurt Angle's going to inevitably come back, you know, based off of rumors or dirt sheets or whatever. Like, wrestling fans, I think, build up a certain expectation about themselves, and sometimes it doesn't live up to it because sometimes things don't happen that way. You know what I mean? We've seen it even more recently on the post-Mania Raw, where it's like it's reached a point where you expect people to appear, so when they don't appear, you feel like upset and disappointed. But, like, maybe they weren't supposed to appear. You know what I mean? Like, maybe there's a bigger story people are trying to tell. Like, I don't know. I think I've seen it happen more often nowadays, especially.
I think we see that a lot. I've seen this in comments to our own videos. In particular, Mike, the video with Finn Balor talking "See You Monday," you know, and the videos we posted and everything. And they're like, "Well, where's he at?" I was like, "Well, obviously he was messing with you guys, you know, and now here he is, right?" You know, people are like, "Well, where's he at? What's going on?" And it's like, "Well, wait, you'll see. Check it out Monday." You know, you don't need to be the one that knows now. Be there. Be surprised, you know, when he comes up. It's okay to wait, you know. But I don't know if it's impatience. I don't know. You know, do you get mad when they don't take out the big bad guy in a season of, I don't know, The Flash before the season finale? Like, are you like, well, they should have taken him out long ago? You know, I mean, are you booking the TV show as you're watching it as well? You know, as we seem to do.
Oh, I absolutely do.
Mike is the guy that does that.
I think that's slightly different because obviously people can fantasy book however they want to book, but like, take for example, I think the most recent example of this is like Bayley. Like, when the post-Mania thing happened, they're like, well, Bayley dropped the belt. That means she's definitely debuting on Raw on Monday. And then she didn't debut on Raw, and everyone's like, wait, where's Bayley?
Right.
This isn't cool. Where's Bayley? And then it happened again during the draft. Like, well, Bayley's going to get drafted. Bayley's got to get drafted. And then she didn't get drafted, and people were like, well, this sucks. And it's like, but then she came back out on Battleground, and it was a cool moment. So just part of me wanted to be like, just wait. Mm-hmm. They haven't forgotten about her. She's clearly important to them. They are doing what they feel is best right now. Just let it play out. Like, not everything has to be, you know, immediate. Like, not everything has to, you know, if they brought up all the people you loved on that post-Mania Raw, then what would happen?
But
those guys would get lost in the shuffle and NXT would, you know, be in a drought.
There's also, like, I think there's also a kayfabe reason for it. Because especially with the, like, post-Mania Raw, anything can happen, and that's a precedent WWE has set themselves. So they've kind of shot themselves in the foot with that.
Sure. I also blame the New York post-WrestleMania 29 crowd for atmosphere.
I apologize.
Yeah, Mike. Yeah.
I apologize on behalf of that entire crowd. Sorg, it's my fault. It was my 30th birthday. They were trying to do something special
for me. I also apologize for the Royal Rumble Pittsburgh crowd. Sorry, Batista.
Yes. At least you didn't win a Slammy for it.
We should have, for shittiest crowd of 2000 whatever.
Yeah, seriously. But anyway, as far as the draft goes, I think the Bayley discussion could have been avoided completely if they just said that the NXT champion, the number one contender for the NXT championship, the NXT women's champion, the number one contender for the NXT Women's Championship, and the NXT Tag Team Champions are not eligible for the draft. Because if you say that, no one's expecting Samoa Joe.
Right.
No one's or expecting Nakamura.
So you're saying
no one's expecting Bayley. No one's expecting Asuka. No one's expecting the Revival. If you don't say that, it makes Shane, Stephanie, Daniel Bryan, and Mick Foley all look like idiots.
So you're saying that WWE is the one, well, at least in this case, improperly setting expectations for its audience.
Yes. Because
I agree.
I'm sorry. Because who were the first people we picked in our draft? Mm-hmm. Nakamura, Samoa Joe, Bayley, Asuka. Like, they were all in our first round.
Yeah, yeah.
They were all in our first round because guess what? They're the best in NXT. Mm-hmm. They're the champions or the people who just lost the championship or who are going for the championship. Mm-hmm. Right. If you don't acknowledge that as kayfabe general managers of Raw and SmackDown, you're being idiots.
I think when we did the post-Mania Mayhem show and Katie was on and she talked about how, you know, it feels like they're pandering almost in a way. Like, and it's reached that point in a way in WWE where it's like, here's all the people you love. You know, and we see that on the main roster and on the NXT. We're going to bring up this guy, and this guy you like, and this guy you like. Like, it gets to a point where it's like, you do that enough, the crowd's going to expect it.
Yeah.
And, you know, it doesn't feel as special anymore.
It's like a like, hey,
they've done that to such a degree, like with NXT guys, with independent guys, with guys like that, like, you know, like, we're going to give you all this stuff. Like,
yeah, yeah.
When, if you do that enough, the crowd's going to expect it.
They're, okay, and not okay. To
mention, they did it so much. Sorry.
Well, it's kind of like this thing happened in tech a bit. Google has a thing where they have a developers thing. And it seemed like they played Oprah every year, where it's like, well, we're going to find out what the Google Glass is under our seats, or the new phone that we're trying out, or this or the other thing, right? And it, to the point where it got too big. Because everybody expected.
So when it doesn't happen, people are like,
so now
what
it
hell?
Doesn't happen, and people are like, what's going on? Google didn't give me free stuff, you know? So you're saying that, so they're pandering into that, which is funny, since how many years ago we're saying they're not creating new guys. Now it's like, holy crap, all these new guys, you know? The guy that our good friend from Fishing Without Bait, we took him to Raw because he hadn't been to a wrestling show in years, and literally the only person he knew was John Cena. And he was happy to see him in that dark match, by the way, to go back to an earlier conversation. But again, you know, so you're saying that they're building that bit up as well. Jake, I want to talk to you for a minute on this because, of course, you work amongst, you know, of course, IWC, AIW, and AIW, as the guys have been fantastically talking about on their podcast, the card. Now I forget, I said it right earlier. The card is going to change. That you can check out on iTunes. They seem to have they get the feedback when people are expecting big crazy things, and their people always deliver big crazy things, it seems, right? Do you have to hear that feedback in that kind of environment around that, right?
Yeah, AIW the past 2 years has really taken off. Because that's been my home since 2010. Mm-hmm. That was the second place I started. And John and Chris have done a lot for me, and helped me out, as well as Pedro, but I hear nothing but positive feedback about it. After every show, everybody leaves happy. And like John and Chris said on the podcast, you know, if they make enough money to fill the envelopes at the end of the night, that's, you know, that's a positive night. And, you know, they're two of the best promoters to work for. The Cleveland crowd is amazing. And just seeing how it's grown from the first show I did, which was in Sandusky, there was maybe 15 people in the crowd, to now, you know, every show is a sellout.
Mm-hmm. But again, but they're still, you know, talking about, yeah, some people aren't happy about X or the doors open late or something like that. But again, that's like a small scale. Like, they see that, you know, whereas we see the broader kind of reaction to that. And I think that's maybe happening at scale with WWE as well. When we're just like, man, everybody's hating this thing because they're the ones that are going to get out and tweet and be in my timeline. Right. but yeah, it is kind of tough when you're watching a show like I do enjoy. And I think. I can prescribe some things, and you guys may have noticed that I'm maybe not in the Google Hangouts quite as often anymore, right? Because sometimes I like to just sit back and take in a show as it was meant to be delivered to me, especially pay-per-views or special events, they're called now, or whatever. Like, fantastically enjoyed Battleground, for instance. which I think a lot of us did. I think that's across the board. I didn't hear a lot of negativity around that show. But so I think like, you know, as much as I like to interact on that on Twitter and everything, like turn that off a little bit. Maybe not be as involved. Watch Raw by yourself for a change if you usually watch it with other people. Because I think that also that general feel in the room, you know, affects how you feel about a show. I have more fun when I watch WrestleMania in a room full of, you know, you guys, you know, whether it be at Carlin's house or my place or that one time at the Art Institute dorm rooms with Chad and LB and all the guys, you know, versus one time I had somebody over and they just bitched about Undertaker the entire time. And it was the worst night watching wrestling of my life, you know, and I never invited them over again.
I had that to a degree last night during Raw. I didn't watch Raw live, but I was following stuff on Twitter and I saw like a group of people on my timeline being like, really, two squash matches? It's like, oh my God, like this is doing something different. And the matches I watched back are good.
Like, meanwhile, all the rest of us are like, they had two squash matches. This is amazing. You know,
yeah, like guess what, guys? Like if that wasn't it, fine. If you wanted to put actual people that are on the roster in those positions, Cesaro would be the one getting squashed.
And what was the discussion last night about how Sami Zayn was not entirely in much of a position except to be put under by Seth over, right? It's like, yeah, or we could have had Seth squash some local. You know, what do you want? You know, you want a good match. You want a good match, even though you know the outcome. You know, you enjoyed the match in the meantime versus just the guy that. The guy that did the math before Braun Strowman was amazing.
Hey, Sorg, that guy made a solid grand.
Yes.
All right?
Yes.
That guy made a cool G.
Yes.
He got 10 Benjamins. And you know, he could have won.
By the way, I don't think the jobber rate is anywhere near $1,000 last I checked. And I think
it has to be now since he said it on
He said on TV.
Hey, you know what? If they're going to give you a live mic on Raw, you set your price. You set your goddamn price. You get to that pay window.
This guy literally went into business for himself. All right.
We were saying last night in the hangout, it would have been funnier if they interviewed the female jobber, and she said, well, I don't know what he was talking about. I get paid $1,200 just for being here. Like have Stephanie be progressive and give women's jobs.
That'd be a wonderful statement. That'd be a fantastic statement.
it's so easy too. It's such a simple thing because Stephanie's technically running that show. It would have been really great.
Yep. She makes the business decisions. All right.
They can still do it next week. They can still do it next week because I'm sure Nia's gonna have another squash.
Yes. This is a completely off this topic, but I just want to get your general thoughts because I feel like the way they're presenting it is the cruiserweight division just going to be random people from the tournament.
Probably
so.
Do we it's going to be like, let's feature some random new guys that have been doing great over here. Like that's really what WCW.
In fairness, that's kind of what the beginning of the WCW cruiserweight division.
Yeah.
Was.
Yeah.
Hey, here's a random guy.
Here's this guy from Mexico.
But then you need. You need the Mike Tenay of that. So who's the Mike Tenay? You know,
he's on SmackDown.
Yeah, I'm gonna say both the potential Mike Tenays are on SmackDown right now.
Yes. Well, I think Corey Graves could do it.
Yeah, that's
Corey
true.
Graves could, true. But it seems weird when you have your SmackDown general manager and your SmackDown lead commentator talking about the Cruiserweight Classic.
That is weird.
The Cruiserweight division's going to Raw.
That is weird. That's odd. And you know what?
I would cut SmackDown a lot more slack if I knew they had a cruiserweight division coming there. As of right now, SmackDown is just struggling.
I do feel like it's the place where they should do that, but I don't know.
I think the reason they're doing it on Raw, I feel at least, is because they have one more hour.
Yeah. But they have all the belts.
But if they have one more hour, then you didn't need to do the, okay, we get two, you get three thing. Because after the Cruiserweight Classic, they're going to get a whole influx of people.
And well, keep in mind.
I hope that all the people they sign from the Cruiserweight Classic don't just automatically go to Raw.
Yeah.
I would love to see Cedric Alexander on SmackDown.
Keep in mind, which I didn't realize about this until I started looking at stuff on the network, main event superstars is still a thing.
Yep.
Yeah.
And they're still doing matches.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Dudley, so like, Dudley boys so like, are big.
You wonder where the Ascension's been.
Yeah, yeah.
They're on SmackDown, but they're still on main event.
And the Dudley boys.
No one wonders where the Ascension's been.
We'll see.
Maybe at Ascension quotes. Maybe that's the only person who's wondered for the Ascension.
At Ascension quotes, Matt Carlin's. Those are the people looking. Guys, it is time for that question to end the week. The most important question of all. What did you learn from wrestling this week?
I learned from wrestling this week that I have missed really intelligently executed dick jokes in wrestling. I really like that opening segment on Raw. And it was all dick jokes, but it was great.
Not to mention the New Day segment was dick jokes too.
Yeah.
I think they were just listening to our banana puns last week, and they're like, oh yeah, we can do that too.
They're listening. Mike, what'd you learn?
Orange, you're glad I didn't say banana.
Oh, I kind of hate you right now.
I learned that Shelton Benjamin's new catchphrase is "Ain't no bookin' me, nah."
Oh yeah, because he was supposed to be on
SmackDown. They advertised him. He never showed up.
Did they say next week or like?
I could have swore they said next week. There are a lot of people on that Talking Smack show tweeting, "Where's Shelton?"
Oh,
there are a lot of people tweeting it. So even if they didn't say next week, they sure gave the impression it was next week.
But yeah.
Yeah. Sorg, how about you? What'd you learn this week?
Sorry, I was putting out a fire. actually, let's go to Jake first. Jake, what did you learn this week in wrestling?
What did I learn this week in wrestling? I learned that last weekend was the last weekend I had off for the entire month of August. So it was really nice to visit my lady who lives 2 hours away from me, spend a weekend with her. But I learned that this upcoming week I have AIW in Cleveland, Ohio. It is Girls Night Out, which is an all-female wrestling show.
Nice.
I believe it's Girls Night Out Volume 18. So there's been 18 of these all-women's wrestling shows. The main event is for the Absolute Women's title, which is held by Heidi Lovelace against Crazy Mary Dobson. Also appearing on the show is Nicole Savoy, Lufisto, Britt Baker, who was recently seen on Monday Night Raw against Nia Jax, Ray Lynn, both from IWC. Who else is on the show? I'm looking at their Twitter right now. See, because they just tweeted out the flyer. Shayna Baszler from UFC is taking on Annie Social. Ray Lynn and Marty Bell against Angel Dust and Brittany Blake. Veda Scott's also on the show. Vanity versus MJ Jenkins. And that looks to be it. So, got that coming up this Friday. Should be a pretty good show. But that's what I learned in wrestling, that an off weekend is very nice.
Awesome. That's awesome. Wheels learned in the chat room. He says 360 entrances rock. He's talking about the video we did with the Renegade Wrestling Alliance this past weekend over on their Facebook page. It was kind of fun to see that kind of up close and personal. A lot of people don't like, literally, if you were that close, I think you would have gotten hit in the face, because I know one of the Wild West like swung their arms out over the camera where I had a position. So, and I'm hoping we can experiment with that some more here at some upcoming wrestling shows. Maybe we'll get an up close personal with Jake Clemens there at IWC, perhaps. Jake, can we strap a GoPro to your head for a match, maybe?
Just going to say, let's do the Billy Silverman WCW ref, you know, like right here. Who did that? I think
Impact Wrestling.
TNA did that.
Yeah.
Oh, terrible. Yeah. Who was it with? It was probably with, like,
I think it was with
who's the dude? bald-headed dude that wore the...
Yeah, Slick Johnson. Slick Johnson.
God. Man, Slick wrestling's Johnson. Weird.
Slick Johnson's the worst. He refereed in shorts.
He did.
I refereed in shorts for the first time ever at Warped Tour, which I feel like is acceptable.
Yeah, you're at the Warped Tour. That's acceptable. That's,
yeah.
I feel like if you're not reffing in shorts, you're not representing the Warped Tour.
my other ref reffed in a cutoff shirt, and like I just felt like such a slob because like my shirt was hanging out and I had shorts on. And I was just wearing tennis shoes. And then I realized, I'm like, these people don't care.
I was going to say, was Gorilla Radio playing during the whole match? Because I feel like it should have.
No, the one video we did at like 2:40. And everybody had bands they wanted to see. Mine was Yellow Card. Because it was Yellow Card's last time ever touring. And I wanted to sing Ocean Avenue. Like, I was like, okay. So I have to see Yellow Card. Our one show just so happened to be during when Good Charlotte played.
Ooh.
So I'm in the ring and I hear Lifestyles of the Rich and the Famous. And I'm just like, they're literally probably like maybe 50 feet from us. And like, we were just sitting there and I'm like, oh, I was like, I should be over there right now hanging out. Instead, I'm roughing a mat. And I got lost for a second. I was like, oh, wait, where are we at? All right.
It's quite an upgrade. Cause I remember Warped Tour like years ago here in Pittsburgh when they had like the goofy Lucha Libre where they threw tortillas at the ring, or like they gave us tortillas to throw at the wrestlers in the ring. An upgrade to AIW wrestling at the Warped Tour is seems like it's kind of a nice up step. So
yeah, it was really cool because like I actually it's at a place called Blossom, which is a music center, and I live 10 minutes from Blossom, so I was able to sleep in that day, you know, get a little sleep, wake up. We had a little trouble getting in because they didn't leave names at the venue, like at the door or whatever, so I had to explain to them like I'm with the wrestling show, and the lady's like, how do you know? And I unzip my bag. I was just like, why would I have ref stuff with me if I'm not with them? Like, you know, and, but that was like the only pain. But once we got in, it was awesome. We all got sunburnt really bad. Got to see bands that we all liked. So we did it in 2011, I think, in Indianapolis and then in Cleveland. And it was just as fun. So it's awesome. I want to do it every year.
Awesome. I learned that even though I haven't been at an indie show, one that we're working for several months, first match in, I get J-Rock yelling at me. Okay. So it was fun to be back there hanging out as well and doing some fun stuff with the camera since we're kind of doing the new configuration for our production for the local promotions. You can check those out, indiewrestling.us. Of course, the IWC that Jay Clemens pops up at. And the Reggae Wrestling Alliance, Jake Clemens at Clemens Jake, because I'm dyslexic to begin with, so that doesn't help me.
No, because I'm actually mad about that, because the actual Jake Clemens on Twitter, I believe, is the saxophonist for the Bruce Springsteen band or something. And I'm just like, dude, like, he's got an afro and, like, I don't know, that's his thing. And, like, it's cool and everything. I'm actually looking him up now because this is – he's ridiculous. Yeah, his Twitter picture is just, like, a silhouette of, like, an afro, some shades, like a crappy soul patch.
Oh, man.
He's got 45,000 followers, which is a lot more than me.
He didn't take him.
All right, Mayhem Nation, your new goal.
You can't take Clemens up to 45,000 followers to show it.
Yeah. There you go. There you go. Give him that blue check mark.
I'm not going to be like some people and buy my followers.
I missed Bobby FJ Town. He learned that Eva Marie can have a 5-star match on SmackDown without even trying. There you go.
She was honestly really like the selling of that was like really well done. Like it took like some kind of like execution level to be like,
oh,
to sell that you
Women's wrestling alive and well on SmackDown live Tuesdays. Eamon, he's I was doing outros, that's right. Inspire Pro Wrestling, he's the voice of that down there in the Texas area. He basically just travels throughout Texas. Sometimes he's in San Antonio, sometimes in Corpus Christi. I hear he might be visiting Dallas very soon. Inspire Pro Wrestling happens out in Austin, Texas. Check them out if you're down there, or go get them on Smart Mark Video.
Yes, indeed. Our next event is on August 14th, which is a little less than 2 weeks away. Lucha Underground star Matt Cross will be there, as well as Cruiserweight Classic competitor Lindsay Dorado. So be sure to check information for that at inspireprowrestling.com.
You didn't answer my Lucha Underground question I had for you last week.
I didn't know about that.
I want to know who that guy is. I want to know who the guy is, but I didn't want to spoil. Yes, I actually listened to Midweek War this week, and also Mad Mike Poughkeepsie, New York, represent.
That's me, Sorg. I'm so glad I know exactly how long my Lucha Underground hangover is going to be.
Nice.
I know exactly how long it's going to be. Like, I'm already going through slight withdrawals.
Mm-hmm.
But luckily, Sorg, I have a remedy. I was given some of Vampiro's medication.
Oh, no.
And, well, I know exactly what I'm going to take it with.
That's a cup. I see a cup.
Props.
Oh, there's a Lucha cup. He's got a Lucha cup. He's got a Lucha cup.
I have a Lucha cup.
There you go. There you go. Yep. Yep, proof that the Mayhem Show can be bought. I thought you were going to tell me to eat a bag of dicks, because I thought it was that medication.
Those are for different symptoms, Sorg.
That's when you have a different medication and you listen to the Dark Lotus album about 15 times straight.
This is true.
Yes. I'm at Sorgatron on the Twitters. WrestlingMayhemShow.com, SorgatronMedia.com. Join us live every Tuesday after SmackDown Live. Live. Podcast day, live.WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. Thank you, everybody, for joining us in the chat room. Brian Crawford from the River's Edge, RiversEdgePGH.com, join us. We got a couple shows over there. So give him a shout-out. Check out some great original music, 24 hours a day. Bobby F. Chaintown, Wheels, of course, of the RWA. And everybody else has popped in throughout the night. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you guys next time. Mayhem out. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com. You guys are cool.